AVA Gallery and Arts Center, everybody, and looking forward to a wonderful artist talk tonight. Thank Clark Derbes for braving the snow through the highs of New Hampshire, through the Green Mountain. He's from Burlington, Vermont. I will let Margaret Jacobs, our exhibition manager, introduce Clark, but a few AVA announcements before that. I'm Tripp Anderson, the new executive director of AVA. I'm the first one who's been able to say that in 30 years. You may have noticed as you've walked here that we've got a new building right out back of our parking lot. That is officially ours now. Its construction is substantially completed. There's a few odds and ends. But as importantly, there are 140 solar panels on that building and on this building that went live a week ago Monday. So we've been harvesting power and harvesting sunlight and generating power for 2 weeks now. And even in the dead of winter, on cloudy days, we're generating on average about 75 to 80 kilowatts of power a day. So exciting news for us moving forward. We welcome Clark. This is the last day of this exhibition. We'll be breaking it down after his talk. And in the middle of February 17th, we'll be opening our annual high school show, which is a big event around here and includes now, what, 15 schools, 16 schools?
Yes,
16 schools from the Upper Valley have already registered a student artwork. So please stay tuned for that. Come see that event and come to our silent auction, which will be April 1st. So I will turn things over now to Margaret to introduce Clark, and welcome again to AVA.
Hi everyone, I'm Margaret Jacobs, AVA's exhibition manager. Clark Derbes received his BFA from Louisiana State University. Recent exhibitions include solo shows at the Devin Barnum Gallery in Houston, Texas, the Clark Gallery in Lincoln, Massachusetts, and Marshall Wood Gallery in Atlanta, Georgia. His work has been featured in the Boston Globe, Art New England, New Orleans Defender, and Art from Burlington. Clark was the recipient of the 2015 Barbara Smale Award, which was given by Burlington City Arts on an annual basis to a mid-career Vermont-based artist. His work combines a unique mix of folk art methods with contemporary painting dialogue. Clark currently resides in Burlington, Vermont with his sculptor wife, Wiley Sophia Garcia, and two children. Please join me in welcoming Clark.
Hello everyone, thanks for coming out. This is kind of the most recent work that I've done, and I have a pretty varied output, and so this is kind of like one little slice of the different modes that I work in. And I'm gonna try to kind of do an overview. I'm gonna have some slides, do like an overview of where I've been working and also the projects that I've got going in the future. And then any time we have, I'm gonna be in the back working the computer. So if you have any questions at any point, just kind of either shout out or raise your hand or whatever. It can be as informal as that. Part of my, I have two small children, one 8 and one 2. When my son was in a stroller, my son that's 8, there's this abandoned interstate section in Burlington that is kind of like in this weird little wooded area. Mostly it's used by skateboarders they built some ramps back there. So I got it in my head that I could just go back there and paint whatever I wanted, whenever I want. And so I started this series of self-commissioned works
and have been working on it ever since. This is the first one that I did back there, and that's me and my son up there on the kind of top right corner. And I've been going back now with my daughter who's in a stroller, and there's this whole system where I push her, and it's about the same distance, the distance from my house where we live to this place is just long enough for her to fall asleep. And so she falls asleep in the stroller, and then I take the paint out and the roller and the little extension pole, and I paint just the duration of the nap. And then when she wakes up, she gets cranky and ready to go. So then I pack everything up and then roll out of there. So this whole series of self-commissioned works on this asphalt stretch that I've done were all kind of like based around my napping children. This is another self-commissioned piece. This is like a series that I've been doing for a few years. A friend of mine had this building that was unrented, and this is the plywood on the doors, and so I asked him if I could paint it, and here you go. And this is another side of that, a series that I've been calling Street Quilts. This is a building in Burlington that this is kind of like a just I like mentally subsidize the private artwork, like the wood sculptures. I do these public art pieces sometimes sometimes I get paid for them and sometimes I don't, but really it's just one of those things that it's almost like a hobby that I really love to do. This is one of the pieces at another site that's like an abandoned refinery right next on the waterfront in Burlington. Just house paint that is like the mist-tinted house paint from the paint store. So it's either for, and then also people just give me paint because they know that I'm doing this stuff. This is a piece that was on cutout plywood. The series of that I was working on that precedes these carved pieces that are in the gallery now were flat on plywood. And then as I was working on that, I had this kind of moment where I figured out that I could carve a three-dimensional object that kind of looked flat, and that's where you get these pieces that are kind of the shelf pieces and the wall pieces that have like a false sense of depth. I just kind of keep exploring all these different ways of painting the wood sculptures to accentuate this optical quality, this like Trump Loy thing that they have going with them, and also just playing with color and playing with paint and playing with, this one was really fun. I was just trying to kind of break out from these very kind of predictable systems that I had been like developing. This one kind of just went like haywire and started like cutting lines across it and going. And this is some of the first carved pieces that I made. I bought a chainsaw in 2007 to make a commission. I'd never carved anything, but I wanted the money for the commission, so I convinced these people that I could make a wood sculpture. So I bought a chainsaw, made their sculpture, and then was so in love with the medium that I just kept carving. But the first few pieces that I made were these hollow geometric forms, and this piece is recent, but it was kind of this return to that initial form of like the hollowed out box. I've always been painting or doing two-dimensional work, and I love playing with color and seeing what colors look good next to the other ones and kind of juxtapose against each other. So this, a lot of these pieces, like that's kind of, there's no plan going into them. I carve the form out of wood and then just start putting color down and kind of one little bar at a time, and then whatever looks good next to that determines the next color bar or square or whatever. This piece is kind of, it seems like there's some kind of like influence by like oceanic art or African art or something like that. But also going back to those to those self-commissioned asphalt pieces, just concentric. There's something about like concentric squares that I like, and this is just one of those things where I'm like, I wonder if this, how this will look. And so this concentric motif is one that I've done in black and white and multicolored on a few different pieces. This is another experiment, just trying to figure out, like, and not just figure out, but like have fun and make something playful that is, to me, these are almost like an homage to Donald Judd's boxes that he had on the box sculptures that he did for as like relief sculptures. Yeah, fun stuff. This is a Google Maps shot of the abandoned interstate spot. So that first photo that you saw, if you look at the very top right or the very top of that, that's that piece. This is from like 4 years ago. Since then, like this past summer or this past spring, summer and fall, I really connected this whole place as one big painting and not just a couple of different ones. This thing, I was looking at how museums present ethnographic objects and like masks. And so I made this metal stand and had this thing not really have a bottom. Like the bottom that's facing down is only like a half inch thick, so it wouldn't stand up on its own. And so I made this rack almost. Also looking at like the way people display guns in museums, the way people display spears in museums, and like, or prehistoric objects. This is another one of the self-commissioned pieces. This one was an actual commission. This was like a mural program in Baton Rouge, Louisiana. That's my hometown. So I did this and was paid and had a bunch of paint left over. So I'll get to the painting that I did with all the leftover paint in a second. This is a Google Earth photo of another spot. This is like the abandoned refinery parking lot right on the Burlington waterfront. This site got demolished in the fall. And so the extra paint from that commission mural, I went down to this spot under the Interstate 10 in Baton Rouge and just walked up on a Sunday morning and painted these columns, and nobody cared. And everybody was, people brought me sandwiches, and there's like this lady brought me like drinks and said, "Wow, what's up?"
I was gonna ask if you had to do it at night.
No, I think if they were done at night, then you're kind of, it's almost like an admission of guilt, like if you're sneaking around doing it. During the day, during broad daylight, it's almost like an admission of benevolency, that it's like this good thing that everybody likes anyway, and obviously like no one had any problems with it. The DPW guys were driving by, the police were driving by, and everybody's like waving at me, and everything's fine. And this was, painting this piece was one of my favorite art experiences of my life, because there was this guy who had a tire shop, and he came, and this is like in a really, really blighted area of Baton Rouge that the high school that I went to was like three blocks over, but this area is really dangerous and really kind of depressing, like visually, and so doing this felt like a just felt right, and the guy who owned the tire shop next door came over, and he's like, "Well, if you're gonna come out here painting, I'm gonna help you." So he helped me paint, and then this little woman that lived in that house right next door to the bridge, she brought me a diet Dr. Pepper and told me I was gonna be blessed, and then some woman brought me a sandwich, and it was just like this, like it just was the best experience I've ever had making artwork. This piece is pretty recent. It's one of the shelf, call them shelfies, just as like a pun. But this is a, I'd say the most difficult piece that I've made, fabrication-wise, the most difficult piece I've made so far in terms of like carving it and painting it. And maybe my, I think it might be one of my favorites that I've made. There's this yard of abandoned, not abandoned, dilapidated tractor trailers in Burlington that they, this landowner bought all these tractor trailers and rents them out as mini storage. And that's what this, that's what their use is, that they have a padlock on one end of them and people rent them out and store stuff in them. So one day I went back there and asked the guy if I could paint on these, on the trucks, because I was making a television show and I wanted something interesting to paint on. And he's like, oh yeah, sure. There's this guy who's like the truck yard watchman and it's a pretty rough character. And he said, yeah, sure, go paint. So this is one of the truck drawings I've done. I've just this in the past, in the fall, I finished the whole yard. So I finished painting all the trucks. And now I've actually taken to going back over and painting over some of these. But this is like, this is my kind of like escapism, like comfort zone, is just going into this truck yard and like this is, and just doing whatever I want, but like on this awesome scale where I get to really like use my body and I'm up on a ladder and using spray paint and using rollers. And this is a little view of the, of Mickey, he's the truck yard guy, his little yard, and then some of the trucks lined up. There's another one. This is a self-commissioned bus bench in Baton Rouge. A friend and I did this. There was this thing was all rotten, and there was like a piece of wood that was kind of falling off the back, and the boards on the seat were all old and busted, and the city hadn't fixed it, and it was sitting there for a decade or two. And so my buddy lived across or down the way from this bench and said, yeah, we're gonna fix this thing. So he cut out the plywood, he had everything ready, and I brought the paint, and this is what we did. And then we took a hammer drill out there and drilled the brackets that they sit on are these two big concrete things. And so we like had a hammer drill and a generator, and this was of course like broad daylight, and no one would think that we were doing anything. I don't know that it's illegal, but because it was clearly something that was needed to happen. But I imagine that you're supposed to either not do stuff like this or get permission by somebody to do stuff like this. So, which is.
Isn't some committee supposed to vote on it?
Yeah, some committee's supposed to vote on it or something. You know, it's just one of those things. The red tape, and the way that I look at like the self-commissioned stuff, it's like I might be able to get permission to do most or all of these things, but like the red tape and all the stuff like involved in like trying to get permission basically makes it not cost-effective to ever even do it in the first place. So it's just like, it's like then it takes time, and then it's, then I'm really losing. And then I'm like actually losing my time, and instead of just being able to like go out, walk out and like create something. This is done with this is like a little sidewall done with leftover paint from another mural. This is a painting on canvas of a painting on canvas. So the gray is like the outside of the actual canvas, but then when you look inside that, it's a painting. So it's just like me just being a jokester or something, trying to be funny. This is a mural in Baton Rouge that I did with my wife, Wiley. We had a crew of teenagers who were paid to do this. Like this was their summer job, or like a week long summer job. They got paid. We were kind of like the directors of this mural on this fence in Baton Rouge. This is the finished project. And it was so hot when we painted this thing. It was like 100 degrees, and for some reason we couldn't do it in the afternoon, and it was just like the hottest part of the day painting this mural and trying to keep the kids from getting heat exhaustion. But it was a lot of fun, and the kids are really psyched, and they were a great crew to work with. This is another truck drawing. This is a mural that we did in my wife Wiley and I did in Burlington. A similar thing where there were a bunch of volunteers that came out to paint, and there's a youth center called the King Street Center in Burlington, and they have kids that go to the center, and then their mentors came out with them to do the execution of the mural. I had the colors, and then I like sketched it out with chalk and kind of just eyeballed it and like did the color layout minutes before everybody started showing up. I just took the paint colors and just dotted the inside of each little square, and then they did all the fill in. But this was, I love doing this kind of stuff. This is kind of like if I could make a living doing community murals and just like have that one after another, I think I would probably choose to do that rather than like private art, which is like the wood sculptures are kind of like private as opposed to public. Another truck drawing. This one I was pretty, so if you look on the kind of bottom left-hand corner, there's like this different texture of spray paint. It's like real fuzzy. It looks like, so that's like some kid's like graffiti tag that I subverted into part of the design of this abstraction. Because the spray paint tips that I use for these are like fancy spray paint tips that spray with like sharp lines. So their little section, the section on the bottom left-hand corner, you can see the kind of fuzziness to it. That's like it's like hardware store spray paint. This is another one. I love the texture of the actual trucks. There's something, so I've tried to recreate these in the studio just on like a painted canvas or something like that, and they just have none of the spirit of the painted trucks because of all this like decades of abuse and neglect of weathering and all this stuff that the truck and these decals and stuff that the trucks have, which is frustrating because I want to like somehow translate it into like an art object, but it's impossible. Aside from like getting a cutting torch and cutting the whole back of this truck off. This is another section of that abandoned interstate spot in Burlington. These are the electric utility boxes that are on the corner in Burlington. And last year, Margaret had mentioned that last year I was the recipient of this award in Burlington. So they have this thing every year they give an artist, it's like a mid-career artist, this award called the Barbara Smale Award. And it's basically kind of like Artist of the Year. And then you have an exhibit in the gallery at BCA. I kind of took my license as like the Barbara Smale winner and like that I had this upcoming exhibit at BCA as this license to paint whatever I wanted in Burlington. And so I went around downtown and I painted all the utility boxes like this. And same deal, I used tape and I went in the morning and clearly I'm not doing anything wrong. Yes, there's some kind of bureaucracy that oversees the painting of the utility boxes. Do I sign? No. No, I mean, I don't see the point in signing them. They're stylistically, I feel an ownership over them anyway. But the point is not to sign them. The point is to just make it better than it was. And when they looked like crap before, they were like all covered in like smeared graffiti from them like painting over the graffiti and then trying to clean it. And it's just kind of like this ugly eyesore. And so I turned it into this thing that looks cool, or at least I think it looks cool. This is another one, and they have this like weird shifting perspective that as you walk around them, it's like you kind of always want to look inside of them, but you can't get inside that little section. This is another one. But yeah, I mean, these are so much fun for me to do, and like the critical part of it is that they're painted in broad daylight, and it's just like this. No one has ever questioned, like, have been like, are you allowed to do that? Everybody's just like, oh, that's really nice, thank you. This is Wiley and my daughter working on a collaborative mural that we did in a venue in Burlington. Some more truck drawings. So as you can see through the truck drawing series, there's just like this, I just want to experiment as much as I can, and I love that scale of going really big, and just kind of like not having any, I don't feel like I have to answer to anybody but myself in that moment of painting these things. And no one, it's kind of like, it's a scary place to go. There's like these guard dogs, there's like a three-legged Rottweiler and a pit bull and this like crazy drunken watchman guy. And like, you don't really want to go back there, like if you're just kind of like in the neighborhood, which to me makes it even better because it's really like this private kind of sketchbook for me where I can like hash out painting ideas and drawing ideas on a large scale and really not feel like anyone's ever gonna see it. This is my daughter sleeping in the stroller right after I did this section with black on this spot. This is a sculpture right after, so this is how I make these things, is my studio, my carving studio is the corner of a parking lot. It's very low tech. And I have a pile of huge logs that I get from arbor crews, from tree guys, and they drop off trees, and then I get a chainsaw and I carve them up. That piece that's on blue is actually behind the screen. That's funny, I didn't think about that. so this is another kind of experiment, and I wanted this to be a diptych, like this to be one piece of art, these two pieces, but I sold the top piece and not the bottom piece, so that was that. There's another photo of the truck yard from another angle. This one was really fun. I love all the like vents and like weird like hookup coupling units or whatever that thing is at the bottom, and like little signs and junk to like kind of skip around with the paint on these things. And like this thing on the top right has this like weird aerodynamic big fiberglass like thing built onto the back of the truck, and just like, oh, okay, I have to like make something that fits onto that weird thing. This is the basement of our home, and I'm watching football and painting, and I use a Frisbee as a palette, and we have a ping pong table / work table, and this is kind of like the studio setup. This is a self-commissioned piece on the waterfront in Burlington, right along the bike path. This was a counterweight for a drawbridge that used to be right where that bike bridge is, right there. So this was like the big concrete weight that allowed the bridge to lift up and come back down. And so when they just wrecked the drawbridge, they just kind of tossed this to the side, and it became part of the erosion protection for the lake is right there on the right, Lake Champlain. And so this thing so just protects against erosion. It had been like covered in graffiti, like high school kid graffiti for years. And so one day I just walked up and did this to it. And it was cool. I was like out there painting. A little bit, it's really super, this is not like some abandoned refinery. This is like very high profile real estate. And that bike path is like the bike path for the whole town. And so this was a little more, I felt like it was a little bit riskier in terms of like walking up and painting it. And like nobody caring or nobody saying anything. But the only people that said anything were, there was like a there's like a National Guardsman who was jogging by and he stopped and he's like, oh, that's really cool. I like that. And then there was like this this grandma pushing her grandkid in a stroller and she stopped and told me that it was really nice. So I feel like if I got the like National Guardsman and the grandmother like giving the thumbs up, I was like, all right, I'm cool. I don't have to worry. This is a little installation, a little wall installation that I did of some of those hollow box relief sculptures. This is just like this, I don't know how to describe this series. I just got this idea in my head of like making a three-dimensional box on this kind of half 2D, 3D object. And I did a couple and really enjoyed it. And so now it's this series where I just keep experimenting with background colors and then colors of the three tones of the box and then and just all these different variations of it. It's really fun. Here's a drone photo of one of the self-commissioned pieces. And so you can see the bike path right there with the two people on their bikes riding by. There was this drain in the middle of the concrete that I had to go around the drain. So I was like, oh, I'm going to make concentric squares. Here's another photo. This is probably from like 100 feet up. This is a show that I had at the Fleming Museum in Burlington. This is another photo from, so that picture of my daughter in her stroller was of this spot, and that's us at the top right there, me and the guy controlling the camera. And this is the whole place. So this is what it looked like when it was finished, and then shortly after this, they just demolished the whole thing. This is an installation that I did in Burlington at a gallery, and I took ink and drew this like lakescape on the wall. And this is a gouache painting that I did of the lake. This is, and these are those these are painted plein air. I just go out to the lake, and this is also kind of one of those things where I was like, how do I kind of keep being doing like dad stuff and be an artist? And so I would push. I started this series with my son in a stroller, and then a couple of summers ago, last summer, I started doing it again with my daughter, where I would like get an easel strapped to my back, push the stroller, she would sit in the stroller, and I'd paint the sunset while she either slept or kind of just sat there and watched me. This is a mural that I did in Baton Rouge. This was commissioned for Martin Luther King Day 2 years ago, and another friend of mine had these football players that he had painted on the columns, and I didn't want to paint over them, so we painted around them. Even they asked me to paint over the football players, and I was like, no way. So that was this project that we did down here. We had like 400 people come out to do the execution of this on Martin Luther King Jr.'s birthday, and I just was kind of like running around telling a crew of people to tell other people how to paint these things. It was fun though. Let's see, that's another part of that. This is one of the wall sculptures. This is one of the first truck drawings that I did, really before I knew that this was like a series that I was gonna be working on. This is a gallery in New Orleans that I painted a mural on the wall. And then this is another one of these pieces that I made like a metal stand for. Let's see. Does anybody have any questions at this point?
Were you concerned about the graffiti artists, the high school graffiti artists being painted over?
They've come and like, they like tag over my stuff and then they paint over their stuff. They tag over my stuff. And then, you know, it's kind of this like fun game. I don't know. I don't think they think it's fun. I think they're probably enraged, but it's, it kind of like keeps it, it's just kind of like part of that space.
Did you ever cross paths with them?
Yeah, they gave me the, you know, they gave me like they were like disgruntled that I was like there with my kid in the stroller and I skateboard at the park, and I think they recognized me from the skate park and knew that I was kind of like the veteran or something like that. I have to kind of navigate this computer for a second here, so pardon me while I find. Let's see, here we go. So I've been working on this television show. My newest thing that I'm working on is this television show that's it's kind of like Bob Ross on acid. And let's see if I can find this thing. Let's see, here we go. So this is the intro for the TV show, and I will, this part of the lecture will get kind of disjointed, but bear with me. So that's kind of like this this thing that I'm working on now, because I've always like wanted to be an art teacher, but I fell into this position where I, all of a sudden I was able to sell my work, and so I just kind of like jumped on it, and I was like, okay, well, if I can do that, I might as well keep doing it. But I've had this idea for this television show really like gnawing at me for several years, and it won't go away. And so I figure if you have a project that's like gnawing at you and you can't ignore it, and it just stays with you for like year after year after year, that probably means you have to explore it. And so this is kind of what I'm doing with this, is like is making these are a couple of the old ones. I'm doing some edits now where basically I'm like filming everything that I do in the studio and then making these videos that are like kind of like, they're like kind of art education, kind of art inspiration, kind of like just in that middle world of like almost like an MTV video, but like an art video. And there's a lot of different people making these like art video, these like how-to art videos that are on YouTube. But I still haven't found anything like really interesting, and definitely nothing that's like paying homage to like art history. So one of the things that I've been doing with these episodes is to put a little like art history blurb at the end of it, where it's like three artists to look up, and then I have like these three artists, maybe past, present, and future, or something like that, to just inspire people to like look up art, look up artists that I never really like knew about art history, or like knew. I didn't pick up an art magazine until I was like, I don't know, 25 years old. And then I like picked up an art magazine and was like, oh, there's this whole thing. There's like galleries and people, there's like this whole art world. And like, I just didn't care or know that it existed. And then all of a sudden it's like, wow, people have been making like some really awesome stuff for the last, whatever, millennia, thousands of years. So I'm trying to do this thing with like the music where you don't have to worry about like music rights if the music's 50 years old. So all the music's 50 years old, and some of it's not. But I've been trying to like stick to it. Plus, I just like the kind of like oldies music. My mom always listened to that stuff on the radio whenever I was a kid, and so it was just kind of like part of what I'm into. So this is the little art history blurb right here. Well, it's coming up. So making this TV show is kind of like what the name of it's Public Art School, but it's really like how I'm kind of tying all the different stuff that I'm interested in together. It's like, oh, this is the way that I can like make some kind of coherent like career or something like that out of doing all these different styles and all these different media. So here we have like the three artists to look up, and there's like the like prehistoric, or maybe I forget where it goes from here, but we'll see. So Jean Dubuffet, he's one of my favorite artists. I definitely want to get the audience's input in these videos, because this is kind of like a, this is like some kind of foreign territory that I'm treading into. don't quite know. It's hard to make sense of like what this is. This is pretty neat. I thought like the oldest artwork was like the Altamira caves, like 30,000 years old. This little stone tool is like 70,000 years old. So there's that. And let's see if I can. So, yeah, I don't know. What do you? Anybody have any comment about that? What's that? Yeah. Thank you. let's see. There's another. I'm gonna show a couple of them. Episode 9. It's funny because my mom it's kind of like a she talked trash on Bob Ross. Like she thought it was like junk art. She was like, this guy doesn't know how to paint. Like, and she thought all his colors were bad and his technique was bad. And so I kind of like grew up like thinking like that was not good art. Like Bob Ross was not good art. But I'm a lot more open-minded now. And like, I don't think there's such a thing as bad art. There's just kind of like everybody has their own thing that they're into. This is, so the idea of like another idea with this TV show thing is to eventually hopefully get some kind of sponsorship, PBS or something like that, and then have each episode be a different medium or a different style. So, and then within that is such a huge capacity for variation, because it's like every sculpture, you know, just you look at like something like clay ceramics, and there's like so many different ceramics processes. There's hand building and throwing and casting and slip casting, and there's just like so many different ways to work with ceramics. And then within each one of those, there's so many different directions to go just in terms of the object that you're making. Same thing with painting. There's so many different painting mediums, and then there's so many different things to paint. I really am like equally passionate about landscape painting as I am about doing the truck drawings, as I am about doing wood sculptures. And so I'm interested to try to like tap into that and say like, oh, okay, to have that accessibility to like, okay, this week I'm gonna make a bronze sculpture, and the next week I'm gonna make a ceramic sculpture, and really trying to like to make this thing happen. But it's really, it's strange because I've approached my studio practice so impulsively, and like this, and so every time I'm in the studio, I'm basically trying to do the easiest, fastest thing that I can do that's the most fun that day, and not think about the future, not think about any kind of planning, or it's like, how do I effectively manage my time so that I can like better my career? I'm not thinking about that stuff. I'm just like, ooh, what do I want to do? I'm going to get the chainsaw and like carve a big chunk of wood, and then I'm going to sand it, and then I'm going to paint it, which is kind of like the quickest, it's like the quick fix, what do I do in the studio? This project, on the other hand, is like so much planning, so much work, so much editing time, so all this, all these things that I've like avoided like the plague. This is like has all of those things, and so it's a little bit tricky, and it's been like really tough to like push myself to make it and to like follow through with it. But like I said, it's like it's been gnawing at me for, let's see, I gotta find this thing that I'm looking for here. Anybody see AVA video? Well, oh, there we go. So, and then I made a few that are like these. I'll draw three sheesh. Let's see. There's like a whole bunch of them that are made in a studio with like a blue screen. And this is the last one that I'm going to show you. And this one lasts forever, so I can just kind of keep talking. So these are like full length, like this is 13 minutes, but so when I went in there to use this blue screen in the studio, they're like, okay, so you can't wear anything blue because it'll turn transparent. I was like, oh, cool. So I went and got a blue sweater and like my blue jeans and then put one camera on the car hood that I was painting on. And then another camera on kind of on me backed up. And then then projected into the blue screen is the camera one that shows like the zoom. And then the me wearing the blue makes it kind of do this like really weird thing. So this is kind of what I'm working on, is just trying to like make something like really interesting to watch. Something watchable, but that's also like a little bit education and just like, yeah. It's like make, yeah.
The last one, if you move away from that, I think this is more captivating.
This is more captivating. Cool. All right. That's good to know. These are, a friend of mine told me he was watching, this is on VCAM, it's like the public access station in Burlington. I have a bunch of these. And he said that he and his son were flipping through channels and he came upon this and they just sat there and watched it for like 20 minutes, just me drawing. I was like, oh my God, that's what I want. That's what I want to happen. I was like, you sure it wasn't too boring? And then I just recently like tried to watch Bob Ross, a Bob Ross video, which are just as long, they're like 30 minutes long, of him without psychedelic effects doing these like paintbrush strokes, and I found it to be like very difficult to watch. I'm like the ADD generation, but still I found it very difficult to watch and to kind of hold my attention, just because it was like so kind of monotonous. So I'm trying to do something similar, but like just to break the monotony and like make it a little bit like silly to watch. And you can't really hear the music on this one that well, but there's like, it's like Bessie Smith or something like that, something really good. I've been trying to like find these like old early rock and roll, and like early blues musicians, and just trying to find like obscure artwork. Also like within the like, on these episodes, I didn't do any of the like artists to look up because it was just a matter of like turning on the camera and then turning it off. And these aren't edited at all. But I've been doing a lot of research right now of like compiling all the images of like the artists to look up. So I think that's it. I'm just going to let this play, but I think that's it for as far as like plannedish lecture. Does anybody have any other questions or comments? Yes.
When you got all done, the kids come and put new graffiti over.
Yeah, they do. And then I paint over their stuff. And yeah. It never ends. I recently went out there and touched up the one that was like the drawbridge counterweight. Some kids had like tagged over it, and I saw it, and I was like, it was funny. I was a little bit aggravated. I was like, it's like, wow, I can't believe he painted something in my white triangles. And so I went back with there with paint and painted my triangles over his stuff. And there's like this, a lot of those street quilt pieces, they're usually two-tone. There's like a light and a dark. Usually what I'll do is let the dark leave the graffiti on the dark. So when he painted over the end cap of those, where those triangles were, all I did was repaint the light colors. And so it leaves the dark areas to be like this really cool collage of like graffiti and graffiti and graffiti and graffiti. And then the light part is the like stark white or peach, whatever color it was. Pardon me? Yeah, just to maintain the design. Because I don't care. I'm not like, for obvious reasons, I'm not anti-graffiti. I think that there's a lot of like vandalism that I think it's, you know, it's rude to like paint on somebody's private property. It's pretty tactless. I can't really get behind, but just in terms of like graffiti on these, like, you know, a lot of graffiti that you see is like on trash. It's like on dumpsters or on like stuff that's like kind of like the ugliest parts of the urban environment. That's what people tag on. And there's definitely, I feel an attraction to those same spots. That's what the utility boxes that I painted were just covered. That was the only time that anybody does anything with those things, is to tag graffiti on them. But I'm attracted to them for the same reason. It's like this little ugly thing that's just sitting in the middle of town. So it feels right to me to be like, oh, well, this is like a forgotten little chunk of the world. No one will care if I like spruce it up a little bit and like paint some trapezoids or whatever. I showed these to my daughter the other day, and she was totally into it. I think the next step with this series of these things in the studio is to like take one of these videos of me painting and put that as the background, and then there'll be like double layered. It'll be like two sets of me or something like that, and then take that video and put that as the background, and it'll just be like this, and it'll just keep adding, just keep taking each episode as I like make another one and like add in that, so it somehow it'll like be like that effect when you stand in front of like two mirrors facing each other and they just kind of go off and forever. I'm hoping like I can achieve something like that, but on with the like me drawing infinite drawings. It's pretty fun because it's like so low tech, and like this is like as budget as you can get in terms of like trying to like make special effects. Like just, yep.
Supposing you did a big thing, put free space. They think they're artists too, but they respect you. Just put some in the free space and not screw up when you work.
Yeah.
Because they're like artists too. You
know? Yeah.
No one like to paint bridges, don't get caught on any stage.
Yeah. Yeah. Really, the only place that I've had that issue, well, no, that's not true. I mean, there's definitely that spot where the abandoned interstate is like, I feel like I'm ongoing, like working on my project there. And like, that's the one spot where I regularly paint over them painting over my stuff. And I like go and I'm like, oh man, my perfect little concentric triangles got screwed up. I gotta paint my triangles again. So I like go and like paint my triangles again. A couple weeks later, I go back and they're like, somebody else tagged over it. But it's all part of like, it's all just kind of part of it. for the most part, the people that are going back there have been like really, I've seen people like jogging back there and everybody's like, oh, this is so cool. You're the guy who does this. And like, just being really like positive and encouraging.
In fact, you have to go back.
But I like it that it's like this, it's like subversive, like dialogue with like between the two vandals. It's like, it puts me in my place. It's like, oh, this is who I'm in a dialogue with, is like some high school kids that are like coming back here and like spray painting like obscene words. And then I'm like painting over their stuff, and then they're painting over my stuff. And it's like, it's kind of this, it's like, oh wow, this is pretty silly of me to be back here doing this. Yeah. Thanks everybody for coming to my lecture.